In the greater West Central region, we do course checks of every online section within our region. In this video, we're going to talk about why we do the online course checks and specifically what we're looking for when we do a course check. Our course checks were designed to ensure that our courses are following the requirements set forth in the Academic Support and Operations Manual, or the ASOM policies. We also want to make sure that our courses are adhering to standard best practices for online education. Ultimately, the goal is to make sure that we're doing everything we can to help our students succeed. There are four ASOM policies that pertain to the setup of online classes. The first one is ASOM 4.5. which is distance education course scheduling. That policy contains information about the common statewide online course calendar. The next one is ASOM 4.6, course delivery considerations for courses at a distance. That policy talks about no-show withdrawal timeframe, otherwise known as non-attendance or the NW date. Also, ASOM 4.8, Attendance Expectations and Reporting, which also discusses the no-show withdrawal dates and the 100% student refund date, which we'll talk more about later in the video. And the last one is ASOM 7.5, which is Faculty Considerations for Distance Education and the Use of Blackboard. This policy specifies certain things that need to be present in each course, such as the instructor information, the current approved course syllabus, as well as the general guidelines for grading. The Greater West Central region uses the IDC Getting Started website to convey the information needed to get your course set up for the semester. The link to this website, which is also provided in the video description, is bit.ly/IDC Getting Started, and the IDC Getting Started part is all one word. On the website, you'll see a link to Ivy Tech Basics, which contains instructions on how to set up your account in Campus Connect, how to access Blackboard, and also how to find your course CRN. Below that link, you'll see a section that contains two links. If you're teaching a face-to-face course, you can click on the first link to access more information. But for this video, we're going to discuss online courses, so we're going to click on the second link, I'm teaching an online or hybrid course. The first link on that page is the course setup checklist, which we'll look at in a moment. Below that is another link for instructions for finding your CRN. There's also a help document here that walks you through updating your course syllabus and instructor information. There's information regarding proctored testing, if your online course requires students to use a proctor for testing purposes. And there's a link to a document with more information about faculty reporting and links to some of the ASOM policies regarding online education. So let's click on that first link to open up our course setup checklist. The course setup checklists are updated on this site as soon as the master calendar for the following semester becomes available. So at the top, we'll see the course information section. The course title should already be filled out for you on the syllabus, and if so, it shouldn't be changed. The number/section part refers to the course number and the section, which are the first two parts of the course ID. So in this example, the number/section is CINS101-00D. The CRN is a unique identifier for each course. It's 5 digits, and it can be found on your course schedule in Campus Connect. The CRN is not part of the course ID. Contact information is the next section. Obviously, that will be different for every instructor, but we do check to make sure that each instructor has provided at least 2 methods of contact for themselves and for their supervisor. This can be email address, work and/or cell phone numbers, Blackboard course messages, Blackboard IM, and so on. Email addresses should be Ivy Tech email addresses, and phone numbers should be direct lines. For example, the main switchboard line for the campus doesn't count as a method of contact because it can't be used to reach you directly. Online learning support information should be present on each syllabus. We have this formatted in such a way that it can be copied and pasted directly into your syllabus. All syllabi should contain exactly this specific information, and it is new for fall of 2016, so please don't reuse any previous contact information that you may have used. The next thing that appears on the checklist is the no-show withdraw dates. You may also hear these referred to as the NW dates or non-attendance dates. The important thing to remember about no-show withdraw is that this is the same date as the student 100% refund date. If a student is not properly dropped for non-attendance in a timely fashion, they may not receive a full refund of their tuition payments, or financial aid monies may be disbursed inappropriately. This costs the college and our students hundreds of thousands of dollars every year. So it's very critical that we post the proper dates and report non-attendance in a timely fashion. The last date of withdrawal appears next. It's important to make sure that you include the day of the week when you put the last date of withdrawal in your syllabus. This date often falls on a Saturday, and if a student needs the approval of a faculty member or their advisor in order to drop a course, they may need to take action sooner than this deadline date. The next section on the checklist is the course calendar. The beginning and end dates for the semester are listed here along with any non-instructional dates. Faculty are not permitted to have course due dates fall on a non-instructional date. This affects courses whose ordinary weekly due dates may fall on a college holiday, such as Martin Luther King Jr. Day in the spring or fall break in the fall. This section also specifies the week during which your course should end, so you can double check to make sure that you haven't inadvertently ended your course early. The syllabus template contains a link to where students can find Disability Support Services contact information on the Ivy Tech website. So we are not required to include this information on your syllabus, but if you would like to include that information, you're welcome to do so. Just select the information that pertains to your course's originating site and then paste that information into your syllabus. The last two items on the checklist don't contain specific information, but they just serve as a reminder that we will also be checking the Instructor Information section of the Course Information area and also the Grade Center. Now we're going to take a look at a sample course. So we're going to click on our course title there, and that will bring us into our sample course. ASOM Policy 4.8 tells us that online instructors are expected to call attention to the attendance policy through posted announcements. Our instructor in this course has posted a brief welcome announcement with some helpful information, as well as a reminder at the bottom there that students need to participate before the non-attendance deadline in order to remain enrolled in the course. The instructor information, the syllabus, and the calendar are all found in the course information section, so let's click on that button and begin our course check. The first item in this area should be the instructor information section. There's a placeholder for instructors to post a picture. The instructor resources button has instructions on how to post a picture. We recommend selecting a picture that shows your personality. This not only helps the students to put a face to your name, but it also helps them get to know you as an individual. It's not a beauty contest, so don't be shy. I certainly didn't choose this picture because I look good in it. I chose it because it tells a story about who I am and what my interests are. I also recommend sharing pictures of pets or other things that are important to you. My dog has served as a course mascot many times, and when I have a student who's a runner, who's a dog lover, these pictures create a connection between us, which is a really nice way to start off the semester. The instructor information should contain at least two methods of contact. The main reason we require at least two methods of contact is so the students have an alternative in case one method of contact becomes unavailable. Let's say, for example, that you prefer Ivy Tech email as primary method of contact. If Ivy Tech email goes down and the only way your students can reach you is via email, they won't be able to reach you. So we need to have at least one alternative method of contact provided here, but the more the merrier. For those of you who aren't comfortable sharing a phone number, you can use Google Voice to create a new phone number, which then rings through to your existing phone. There are several benefits to this, one being that the number can be deleted after the semester ends, so you can use a new Google Voice number for each semester. Google Voice also transcribes voicemail messages and sends them to you via email. I've found that when I post a Google Voice number and inform my students that it's a cell phone, and I ask them not to call after 9 p.m., they have all so far been respectful of that. If you have a student who does not respect that and it becomes an issue, then you can always delete that Google Voice number, so that's a good alternative. There's also space in the Instructor Information section for including your biography. Please include a brief, professional, and personal biography. What you decide to share may vary, but studies have shown that instructors who bring themselves to the table, so to speak, create a comfortable environment for the students to open up. When students are welcome to contact you using a method of communication they feel comfortable with, when the students are able to put a face to your name and get to know you as a person, they feel more connected to the course. And students who are able to form that connection are more likely to be engaged in the materials, and they're more likely to reach out for help when they need it. Ultimately, these students then are more likely to be successful in the course. Below that is the course syllabus. So let's open that document and begin our syllabus check. The first thing we check is to make sure that the current standard syllabus was used. The course syllabi undergo changes every semester, so old syllabi should never be reused. And yes, we can tell. The first thing we check is the course information at the top. Make sure that the course number and section are filled out and that the CRN is the correct 5-digit unique identifier. Remember, the CRN is not part of the course ID. We see a lot of people use the last 6 digits of the course ID in the CRN section here. That's actually the semester code, and that is the same for all courses. So be sure to reference the document in the Getting Started website to make sure that you're getting the correct CRN. Also make sure that the text color is changed to black. Red text can create accessibility issues, so the text in our syllabi should always be black. Contact information for the instructor should match what appears in the instructor information area. As discussed earlier, at least 2 methods of contact should be provided for both the instructor and also for the instructor's supervisor. The online learning support information should match the information that appears on the Getting Started website. No other names should be included here, and no other contact information should be used. Again, please be aware that this information is new for the fall 2016 semester, so please don't reuse any information that you may have used prior to the fall 2016 semester. The next thing we look at is on page 8 of this particular syllabus, though it may be on a different page of another syllabi, and that is the attendance policy section. The attendance drop deadline, again, this is also called no-show or non-attendance or NW date, it should match what's on the checklist. If the date that you have posted does not match the checklist, then that will be flagged and you'll be contacted with a request to change that date to the correct date from the checklist. Again, non-compliance on this costs the college and our students hundreds of thousands of dollars per year, so we can't stress enough how critical this is. A few sections farther down is the last day of withdrawal section. This should match what appears on the course setup checklist also on the Getting Started website. Again, these dates will be different depending on whether your course is a 16-week, a 12-week, or an 8-week. The last section we look at is the course communication section. Instructors should choose either course messages or email, or if you would like to allow both, you can just change the wording, as I've done in this sample course, to indicate that students may use either method of contact. There's a section below that for additional communication options. I've added Blackboard IM, an alternative phone number, and GoToMeeting. What you include here may be different, and it should be tailored to your and your students' communication preferences. When you're filling out this section, it's important to remember that when your student is able to contact you using the communication method they're most comfortable with, they're more likely to communicate with you. A student who communicates more is more engaged, and they're more likely to succeed. The next thing we look at is the course calendar. There are 2 versions, the printable version and what we call the viewable calendar below. Both of these should be filled out, and the dates on both should match. In this sample course, I've used Monday due dates. That means for Labor Day, I had to make the assignments due on Tuesday instead of Monday because Monday is a non-instructional day. In the fall, having Monday due dates also affects fall break. Because fall break is Tuesday through Sunday, a course with Monday due dates could technically have assignments due on the Monday of that week. However, because the semester is 17 weeks long and courses are only 16 weeks long, that would lead to having your course end 1 week early. So in order to make sure that my course spans the entire semester, I skipped the Monday of fall break and had the assignments due the Monday after fall break. In the spring, because spring break begins on Sunday and ends on Saturday, if you use Sunday due dates, you would not have assignments due the first day of spring break, because that Sunday is a non-instructional day, and then you would have assignments due the first day following spring break, because that Sunday is not a non-instructional day. These two scenarios are where we see the most issues with course calendars. When it comes to course calendars, we tell instructors to remember two things. First of all, assignments cannot be due on non-instructional dates, so no non-instructional dates can appear on our course calendar here. And the second thing is that all courses should have a number of due dates that corresponds to the length of the course, and all courses should run the entire length of the semester. For example, a 16-week course should have 16 unique due dates. The course should begin the week the semester begins, and should end the week the semester ends. We generally perform course checks within the first week to 10 days of the term. Then later in the semester, we go back into the courses to make sure that grades are being entered. ASOM 7.5 states that assignments should be graded within 7 days of the due date, unless otherwise communicated to the students. Timely feedback on assignments is critical to student growth and success. Not receiving timely or adequate feedback can result in ambiguity, confusion, frustration, and disengagement on the part of the student, which can ultimately result in failure to meet course objectives. We understand that sometimes students may be submitting papers or projects that require additional time for grading, or a student may be submitting work late. So when we look at the grade center in a course, we aren't looking for every single assignment to be graded. We're just checking to make sure that grades are being entered and that a reasonable number of submitted assignments have been graded and that announcements have been posted regarding any assignments that are 7 or more days beyond the due date that haven't been graded yet. The vast majority of our online courses meet these expectations. One example of a case where we would mark a course as not being compliant in this area would be if no assignments have been graded in 4 or more weeks and no announcement or explanation has been provided to the students. And that concludes this video regarding online course checks in the Greater West Central Region. We hope that this video has helped to explain why the course checks are performed and why the things that we check for are so important to you, the college, and also to our students. If you have questions or concerns, please feel free to contact our office at gwc-online@ivytech.edu or call our office at 765-269-5154.